Hello, this is the end of week review of the first week of Understanding Language Massive Open Online course by the University of Southampton, hosted in the Future Learn platform. I am Manuel, I am a former language teacher and I'm currently a lecturer in online teaching and learning here at the University of Southampton. And I am the team leader of the facilitators of the online courses in the university, and I lead the facilitation team of this course. Hello, Kate.
Hello, I'm Kate Borthwick, and I'm the course designer for this course. I'm a senior academic developer working in modern languages at the University of Southampton. And by background, I'm also a language teacher and a language learner, but now I'm an online materials and course developer. So, we've come to the end of week one. What's happened in week one, Manuel?
Lots of things have happened. We have had 7,000 learners in this course, Kate.
Fantastic.
And 2,500 of them have posted something, at least one comment. We have a total of 12,000 comments, and we are only in the fifth day of the course. This makes an average of 4 comments per person.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for all your comments. That's brilliant. That's really making the course very vibrant. So keep those coming. I did notice actually during some of the comments, some of you have been asking about our online masters in English language teaching. Now, as you know, this course is a taster of our online masters, which we run in collaboration with the British Council. Just to briefly say a few words about that, the online masters runs over 2.5 years. It's a part-time course. We have 2 intakes. So you can join the course in January or September of any year. So you have 2 opportunities to sign up and start. Designed to be very flexible. So all of the people that take our masters are working full time or they have family commitments and they take the course and they fit it around their life. So it is part time and it is very flexible. So if you're thinking that you might be interested in doing this course, then but you're not sure quite how it might fit with your life, then please contact us and we can talk through how that might work. I'll put some contact information as a link underneath this video, but you can contact us by registering interest on step 1.18 or step 4.19, or as I say, following the link underneath this video. Please join us on the masters. It's very hard work, but it's designed to fit in with your teaching and to be a reflective kind of learning process where you're sharing your work experiences with your master's learning. So please join us. It's hard work, but a lot of fun, I think.
Well, it is. I did it. I did this course. I didn't do it online. I did it full-time and on campus, but I want to think it has made me a better teacher. And, well, coming back to the course, there's been very interesting conversations and there's been steps that have been really followed. For example, the bottleneck hypothesis step. We have only in the first step of this set of steps, we have had 700 people posting in that step with all sorts of questions and all sorts of comments on this on this theory by Romiana Slapakova. Any of these comments you would like to highlight?
Yes, I think so. I mean, it was really interesting, and many of you really liked that metaphor, that image of the bottleneck. When you're learning a language, there's things that you don't know, for example, the grammar, which stops the flow of the language, and many of you liked that very much. Although many of you also disputed that metaphor of the bottle with the idea that as your language learning changes and evolves, that bottleneck, which is stopping you producing language, actually should widen because the language flow becomes easier. But also, the things that you used to find difficult, now you find easy, and so on. And this changes all the time. And Olga, I think, also had a very interesting comment. She felt that our native language ought to be, rather than a bottle, a bucket, which has all of our language abilities in it, And obviously a very wide neck to allow complete and free flow of language.
Yeah, it's very, it's easier to pour, yes.
Exactly so, yeah.
That makes sense, that makes sense. So,
just to finish on that, Professor Slobarkova has published an article about her theory, and I'll put the link to that under the video. She's also just written a book, it's just been published, and so I'll put some information about that as well. If you want to know more about it, then please look for that book and you can find out more about how she describes the theory and what it means. Certainly, when we talked in the course about what was hard and what was easy in language learning, many of you actually came back and said that in English language learning, things like phrasal verbs and idioms are particularly difficult.
They are for me.
Now, I think the thing with phrasal verbs and idioms is that they are wonderful pieces of language to learn because they are very particular to particular contexts. And certainly when I've learned language, I've always enjoyed learning about idioms because they really capture something of the culture and the way that a people express ideas and the way they think. But with phrasal verbs and idioms, you pretty much just have to learn them. Isn't that right? What do you think?
I had to learn them, and as a teacher, I had to teach them as well. And well, to be honest, although they are very important, I would not put them as top priority for starting learning a language, because I was able to get by without them, and I think my students are also able to get by with just a basic understanding, of both phrasal verbs and some idioms. The context is, though, really important, and knowing when to say either a phrasal verb or an idiom is of paramount importance. Otherwise, you will lose the meaning completely.
Yes. Absolutely. I think one of the other things we've talked about this week is discussions coming out of our poll. So we asked you what was the most important factor in language learning, and what was the answer?
Motivation.
Of course.
Yes, it was motivation. 1,000 people said that motivation is the most important factor, and these 1,000 people is 75% of the total of all the respondents of this poll. Second is natural ability, and third is age. Actually, in age, there have been really interesting debates and really interesting conversations about when is the best age for learning a language, and whether children learn better than adults. And they have even raised the critical period theory, which is an interesting one. I will post the link to such a conversation. Who Junita started. Hello, Junita, and Stefan and Alejandra have contributed to it, as well as me and Josh, the other facilitator. Anything else, Kate?
I think that's it. That's the end of week one now. If you want to talk more about age and language learning, we will cover that in week two when we talk about classroom teaching. It comes into the discussion video that you'll watch. So think about it again then. Thank you very much for all your comments. Keep them coming and keep telling us about your practice. I look forward to seeing you in week two.
And I'm also looking forward to reading all these comments that you will be posting. They are all very interesting, and I'm actually learning. And this is the fourth time we run this course, and I'm still learning from you guys. Thank you very much for
always
this.
More to learn.
And see you next week.
Bye-bye.
Bye.